She's our next speaker. What I wanted to say was that one of my very, very good friends, whose name is Janine Sadiq, she works with me at the Laszlo Institute. She was going to come and present to us. I've seen her presentations before, they're very, very good. But unfortunately, about 2 weeks ago, she said she couldn't make it. But she said to me, but don't worry, you're going to have Jan Rack coming along to present in my place. And I didn't know about Jan before. But she's told me he's a great guy and we must listen to his presentation. So I'm really pleased that you've come in, stepped in, and presented this to tell us a little bit about yourself and then over to you.
Thanks a lot. Right off my talk is a big and strong kid. It's motivated by the notation of quantum physics, big and strong principles and so on. So, first of all about me, so my background is that I'm an experimentalist in ultra-relativist in ultra-conditions at CERN.
Oh my god.
So my background is kind of in quantum physics and especially in the relativistic quantum theory. And that's exactly the topics what I'm going to talk today about. I'm kidding, obviously. So, I will be rather starting with the words of Laszlo from yesterday. So then he said something and then we have to develop our understanding of the nature of reality and the nature of consciousness. So that's something more I'm into it. And the reason what I want to say that we had a huge discussion yesterday and also today about how to propagate the paradigm shift. Yes. Society, I think the main important thing is that whenever the idea we have about what the reality is and how to go further and so on, the most important thing is to convince billions of people.
Exactly.
Billions of people, and that's kind of the tricky point here, I think, because my story shows you something, or I wanted to emphasize here, that it's not only about to write an intelligent, very good paper and to publish, but it's about there are also forces in the science, in the society itself, which are kind of having a different ideas and they are kind of imposing some, directions in the evolution of the whole society. And this is very much related to the story I picked up of Nikola Tesla. Okay, so in order to make really a big impact and convince millions of people, I think it's important also to have something which can be materialized in reality such that people can see and understand the origin of that. And that's why the nature of reality, it's kind of, this scientific approach, which for some spiritual based people means quite often that scientists are all kind of dumb and I don't want to listen to it. I think it is important. Also the scientific point of view, but the open mind of this. And then the second part of the last piece of my talk, I will be mentioning what do I think about the nature of consciousness, which is related to this strong paradigm shift. Where do we are now? So the big paradigm shift, in a sense, I will kind of try to convince you that the small shift in a view will always lead to the big change in reality. In a sense, so I call it my version of the butterfly effect. So we have now some theories where everybody believes, space, time, forces and so on. And then a little change in the kind of way how we see this quantities can really lead to the fundamental reorganization and kind of rethinking of what reality really is. Then the big paradigm shift, I think that's the thing very difficult kind of to comprehend. And at the end, this big paradigm shift, I will explain later, leads to my opinion into an understanding that there is actually no reality at all. So I'm going to demonstrate that there is no reason not to question any fundamentals of the current prevailing paradigm.
Yeah.
Thank you. And I'm still speaking as an extreme physicist. Okay, so big paradigm shift in physics. So we are living in the era of Albert Einstein's special and general theory of relativity, and obviously the quantum physics and quantum field theory. And the important thing is now, and I'm always kind of, making fun from my students, that the majority of this is more than 100 years old, right? So it was, beginning of the 20th century, and so this is very old stuff. And I asked my students, what do you think was the last major discovery in physics? Do you have some opinion about that?
Newton's law.
What?
Newton's law.
Sure,
gravity waves.
Gravity waves. It's a very good point because that's the big part of my presentation. But
the Higgs boson.
But to my opinion, the major discovery, physics discovery, which was reported in 1948 for the Nobel Prize, went to discovery of transistor. Because the discovery of transistor has had a very huge impact on the whole society. Everybody has a lot of transistor around, right? But later there are also some shoelaces and so on. But the majority of the Nobel Prizes these days goes to, some cosmology, something very peculiar, 30 million years ago. Gravitational waves, do you believe the gravitational waves, these LIGO and Virgo experiments, they detected the gravitational waves of order of 10 to the minus 18 meters, which is, the 1,000 of the dimensions of the protons, right? And I will show you one other experiment which somehow has made sense in the perspective of this gravitational wave discovered by this LIGO experiment. But okay, so the idea is that this is old stuff, right? What we have now. So if I take the general relativity, right? So we have from this kind of materialistic, what we have discussed now for already the second days, we have a kind of prevailing view, the paradigm, which teaches us that the universe stems out from nothing, there was a singularity and so on. And this is all based on Einstein equation of gravity, right? Which I will not discuss in details, but the one important thing is that what Einstein believed that, or what the general relativity is about, that the gravity is actually a consequence of the space-time deformation around the massive body. The point is that in order to kind of save this prevailing view, and that's the, it is really so, nowadays the cosmologist needs to invent kind of all this dark matter, dark energy, even on the dark radiation people are speaking about. And at the end, we have only 4% of what we see. They claim that this is only 4% of what we see. In the reality, we have in our heads. And the rest, 96%, we don't see. I think this is is there anything else can be more unscientific than this? So the reality, okay. So there are some pros, we have to be fair, if we are either more kind of to dismiss anything, but these are the special relativity. We don't have, for example, any particle accelerator. We do not have ourselves. So that's our everyday experience. I'm working with the special relativity every day. But for example, the general relativity corrections, the clock kind of correction there, every satellite in the GPS system has an atomic clock. And these are the correction of the general relativity. The resolution would be, meters, although now is the resolution of order of kind of almost centimeters. What is not known to the society is that the, GPS was developed by military. And the military, they don't care what the scientists, academia thinks about, Einstein or Newton or whatever. So they do the correction what are needed and they don't care where are they coming from. So what is less known that the GPS correction also uses the Sagnac effect correction. The Sagnac experiment was one of the not publicly known experiments which proves that the assumption of general theory of relativity are not correct, you know, because the second method shows that the reference planes, that there is the, you know, that there is no democracy between all the reference frames as stated in the general relativity. So there is a preferred reference frame. If you would be interested, I can give you some references later, right? And then the discovery of gravitational waves, Virgo experiment and so on, I have my reservation, but I agree that this is a fact, obviously. I have presented in many papers now. Downside of our understanding is, we all know that there is a huge conflict between the quantum physics and general relativity, which comes from the fact that Einstein was a classical physicist. He thought in terms of classic field equations, but the quantum physics is something completely different, and there is no way how to kind of make a peace between these two approaches. From more kind of you know, open-minded thinking, like, for example, the gravity, you know, there is no access to anti-gravity, for example, speed of light limitation, you know, the signal propagation and all of this. Then and there is also this dark matter energy era in cosmology, which I mean your personal opinion. Then it comes my favorite Nikola Tesla into the game, because I think the roots of the current paradigm goes back to Nikola Tesla. I think he was the real guy who should be maybe blamed for the current situation, because we know he's the father of the AC current, all the, you know, electric motors and I don't know what, radio. Some people call him that he's the man who invented the whole 20th century, right? So his impact, you know, everywhere you look here around, you will see kind of invention of Nikola Tesla. It comes back to Nikola Tesla. He was so ingenious, he has so ingenious ideas. What is less known, or relatively less known, that Nikola Tesla rejected the whole concept of Einstein's general relativity as being the, you know, concept of the space-time deformation. And also, what is known, that he made an important discoveries which were dismissed from the public side, namely the dynamical gravity and zero-point energy. If you Google today, if you put on Google dynamical gravity, the first five or so citations you will see goes to Nikola Tesla theory of dynamic gravity, but no further information, because this all information has dismissed, you know, after Tesla died, the US government confiscated all his papers and notes, and this is all now gone. Right? In 1903, and that's the major point here, which somehow I will discuss also at the end of my talk, Nikola Tesla approaches his supporters, George Westinghouse and J.B. Walker, and he was kind of to share the excitation with them of his discoveries related to his dynamic gravity and zero-point energy. And what's happened, this is now, you can say, speculation, but it's very, you know, there is a lot of reason to believe that, that they probably understood the gigantic potential of this discovery leading to the freedom, liberating people from the matrix. Can you imagine that everybody has his own source of the, you know, zero-point energy without need of, you know, paying the electric companies and everything? How big impact it could be, for example, for communication or transportation, you know, all that we are ruining the planet, you know, using the fossil, you know, oils and things like that. This all will be gone, right? And also this dynamic gravity energy later, how big impact it also will be. So, in a way, the reaction to that, they realize this gigantic potential, so they just shut down all the funding of Nikola Tesla, and they actually kind of forced him to, you know, isolate him from all the society, and at the end he died in the poverty without any contact and so on. Also, he was the brightest man of the whole, you know, human history. Right? So, and that's what will happen to everybody nowadays. I think maybe not so serious, but this is a very standard you know, story which will happen to everybody, who will come with something, you know, revolutionary. So if he is not supported by bigger kind of community supporters and so on, so he will be very likely dismissed like as Nikola Tesla. There is a, you know, very interesting observation. For example, if you look at any physics textbooks for the high school of children, so you will find everywhere the biggest, you know, inventor of all ages were Edison, right? Edison was invented everything. Also, he lost, you know, he was a rival of Tesla, but he lost all this, you know, getting the AC, DC current, you know, all these stories, and Nikola Tesla, the Edison was actually more, he was also obviously very clever guy, but he was mainly a businessman, right? Right, so then, so that's the story. So now, let me focus a little bit on this dynamical aspect of the gravity, and I apologize, it will become a little bit technical, but so let me first say that the first algebraic formulation of the gravitational inverse law was introduced by Newton, kind of 300, now it's 338 years ago, right? So that's a very old formula, you know, the force is here. It's proportional to the square of the, you know, interacting masses and inversely proportional to the distance square. It's, you know, one can find a lot of very, very interesting information about how he discovered this law. I mean, Newton was a very, you know, brilliant guy, and the fact that someone can really connect his intuition such that he can kind of correlate the extra kind of terrestrial you know, dynamic of the, you know, stars on the sky with the everyday life, you know, the same laws actually governs also the, you know, behavior of the objects surrounding me, that was so ingenious inside the bodies, and I'm thinking, you know, I'm kind of amazed. Also not so well known that, you know, he is a, you know, when someone very clever also can see that there is some connection, but it's not so obvious at all that this force will be proportional to the product of these two masses, you know, and that's very interesting phenomenon, which is also not known to anybody, and it's not, you know, teachers are not aware about it, that he did very clever ideological thinking, kind of very clever rational thinking, which led him to, you know, I can show you the formula, but that would be too much for here. But all his followers, like, you know, Lorentz, Kulomb, and so on, I will show later also that the laws of electrostatic force or magnetic force has the same form. There is a charge and divided by R square or magnetic dipoles and so on. And they never did that as carefully as Newton, and they adopted, essentially, they like this formula. So they said it must be something similar. So since then, we have adopted, but now if you read the history, you will find that Coulomb, you know, Maxwell, and all these guys have somehow really mathematically or experimentally proven that in the electrostatic case, then the formula will have the same shape. That's interesting. But what I wanted to emphasize here, that the gravity in this case is really static, you know, there is no time derivative or nothing, everything is static, you know, everything depends on the, how heavy the masses are and how far they are from each other, and that's the same for Einstein's general relativity. Why I am kind of speaking and so interested in the dynamical gravity is that I joined some while ago the Private Research Institute in Prague. Somehow, you know, I'm still keeping my position at CERN to meaning that I'm a mainstream physicist, you know, not only if I do that. And we have the kind of Renaissance University, which is the multidisciplinary open science project, privately funded. And my first kind of the way how to get into this university, into that institution, is that you have to jump the parachute, you know, with the experience that we've got. I think this is, I would really like to recommend that to everybody, because we will hear a lot about the meditation and things like that. We have a theory which I will show you the speech of that theory at the end of my talk, but there is very mystical experience which you can enjoy only in the free fall, and it's related to the fact that if you know how you alter your consciousness in the meditation, meditative state, that somehow you kind of try to calm down your thoughts, right, and you kind of get more into this inner where the thoughts are not bad.
The most obvious one is telepathic.
Well, I will come to that. And so that's the meditation, but in the free fall, on the free fall, usually takes 40 seconds, 30 seconds. And what's happened with your brain is that your body, your consciousness is in the state of the last moment before you somehow die, right? So that's the fight for life, you know? Not kind of conscious, you know that you are still the parachute here, but as you are falling, your brain, your consciousness switch off every kind of thoughts, kind of patterns, and anything you think that I have gotten to buy for them to my kids, whatever I have to do, my father's house, you know, things like that. Everything is switched off because your brain now operates in the mode, I want to save my life, right? And if you do it, you know, I have 200 jumps, so I don't feel the fear anymore, but still, whenever you kind of, you know, step out from the airplane, the different mode of your consciousness always switch on, and I think it has a big impact on, you know, how this consciousness alters the reality. For example, you know, there are a lot of books of how to fulfill the wishes, right? So I wish, for example, to get rich, right, or something like that. Then, you know, there are methods how to do that, but if you can keep the focus in the moment you jump out from the airplane and you keep the focus on the wish, something, right? I usually wish to get the Nobel Prize, you will see it, right? You know, this thought, if you are able to keep it, then because it's extremely difficult, you know, it's extremely difficult to jump and think, I have to get the Nobel Prize for something like this. So then that's really, so I will stop here. It's extraordinarily interesting and kind of alternative way to the meditation, and it actually stands out from our theory, how the thinking works and so on, but this is a very difficult one. Okay, let me move on. I want to mention here that we have one of the directions we developed in our institution is that we have gravity research, right? So and we have constructed, and I will not go into the detail, but it's just for curiosity, you know, we have constructed some, you know, double arm pendulum with very particular, very interesting features. So it's balancing on the mass of the instant, so, you know, whatever. And there are some interesting features already before, you know, discussing some deep general relativity issues, that the pendulum never stops swinging. It's actually in perpetual motion, so it's clear kind of that. But the model, according to the current understanding of the physics, it's a perpetual model. And it swings, you know, when we constructed it 2 years ago, since then it never stopped. It swings all the time, right? Then there are some, and there are indications, which I will not go into the details, that this pendulum allows us to trace or to see the dynamical gravitational forces. There are also hints for repulsion, so kind of anti-gravity. This is an example, you know, this is the amplitude of this pendulum and it's swinging, and that's, for example, was taken during the night, so the swing is a couple of millimeters, and when there is a quiet, you know, environment, nothing is moving around, then we also see some extraordinary signals coming from, what I believe, from, because there are cosmic signals, we have to prove that, you know, we are now building the moon and so on. So I think that's very interesting, you know, that's kind of example of how this period looks like, so it never stopped, really, 2 years later, it's still sleeping, right? We can, this pendulum is also sensitive to the celestial activities, like for example, we have the curve which really traces, you know, the moon period around the Earth and so on. So we can really, you know, this itself, it's sensitive to the kind of logical configuration, right? Astronomical, but also astrological. Right? So there is another example of this kind of unexpected events during the night period, nothing, you know, that during the night period should look like that, and suddenly, you know, because, so to my opinion, these are the gravitational waves, but they are kind of much stronger.
Is that would be an easy way of discovering them?
Yeah, look, the sure. But the thing is that we are now building kind of a correlated system such that we have also the pending underground, you know, shielded from all these, you know, possible noises and everything. And if we can, you know, now it's kind of, I cannot go to present it somewhere, but once we have the correlated signals from different kind of stations, then, you know, it will be difficult to argue. But, you know, that's why I'm saying just the hint, not the proof of anything yet. Then we have developed something which I call bright matter project, which goes kind of against this dark matter, dark cosmological thing, what this is. And you cannot see that much, but one of the current kind of consequences of the, you know, parallel use is that people have in the 70s, I think, discovered that you cannot see that the galaxy spiral arms. And people discovered that the stars outside, you know, from the, as a function of distance from the center, the stars are moving too fast. They are too fast. If you take kind of the Newtonian gravity, and in this situation, in this global scale, it is identical to Einstein's general relativity, you know, that there is no difference in these scales, you know, then the velocity of the orbital stars in the galaxy should go as 1 over square root of r, where r is the distance from the center. But it doesn't, you cannot see it here, that we saw the measurement discovered in the 70s, that this would be the expectation as a function of the distance from the center, from the galaxy center, but the measured orbital velocities are kind of rising on a constant or something like that. So that was a big kind of, you know, disaster for the Einstein theory of relativity. And there are some ways of how to rectify that. The majority, the mainstream science accepted the notion to save these kind of equations. They have postulated kind of this dark matter presence. So they said, you know, the galaxy is filled by, you know, 96% of the galaxies is dark matter, dark energy, and this kind of rectifies these equations, right? So it's not anymore one of them because there is more mass, which we don't see. But, you know, it's kind of difficult. There are also alternatives, obviously, for example, about the modified Newtonian dynamics, or the modified Newton laws, kind of the gravity. So there are some people, but these are essentially, you know, there are also mainstream opinion, but these are kind of dismissed now, prevailing view, dark matter. Right? So when I started kind of to think about, I realized that it goes much deeper than I ever thought. And now I will present you the view which I kind of I'm involved with, and some of it. I apologize, it will be now a little bit technical, but still, you know, in 9 years ago, there was a book released, which is called Relation Mechanics, and something else also, you know, implementation of the Mach principle with better gravitational force, right? And this book is, to my mind, you know, it summarized the research of André Assis, the professor on the university in Brazil, right?
Sorry, is that the Weber bar?
Right, exactly, right.
Oh, it's nice.
Right, and, you know, that's the photo of the Weber detector, which was the first who has detected the gravitational wave. He's kind of the LIGO and Virgo experiments are talking about. But there was another Weber also, and it is the kind of new reformulation of the whole mechanics, you know, the Newton mechanics, you know, Einstein theory, and so on. So I cannot speak too much into the details, But interesting observation is that although this is really a revolutionary piece of work, it's totally ignored by the mainstream science. But you know, this guy, this Assis, is not kind of rejected from the academia, but he's just ignored. Right? And this, the idea really comes back to the Mach principle. You know, Newton, when he derived his equation of motion, he came up with the Gedanken experiment, maybe that if you have a bucket of filled of water in a dress, right? So, and if you will have some observer observing the surface of the water, he will find out that if the bucket and the water is in a relative rest to each other, that the water is not moving with respect to the walls of the bucket, then the water will be flat, obviously, the surface, right? But if you can make the bucket rotating, then you will realize that after a while, if you let the system rotating for a while, then the relative motion of the water inside the bucket and the bucket itself will also be at rest. You know, there will be no relative motion. And still, you will see this parabolic complicated shape, right? So Newton was aware about this kind of conceptual ideas, and he was asking, what is the source of this centrifugal force? Where is this force coming from? And I will show you later that he has a very kind of, at that time, he has a good argument to believe that this force cannot have anything to do with, you know, all objects in the universe, galaxies and stars. So he kind of attributed this kind of gigantic potential to the empty space. So Newton has invented the notion of absolute space and time, right? And so in this era, people believe that, you know, if you have a binary star system, so you can like the moon and the Earth, then you are sitting on the Earth, you watch the moon, and there is a big gravitational pull, right? But the push is fictitious, right? That's the kind of virtual force, because if you are in that system, you cannot see anything, you know. So you see rotation with respect to the stars, but you ignore them. So then you say it's a fictitious force, which is kind of obviously has something to do with rotation with respect to the empty space. So that was a Newton idea. And then at the time later, you know, Berkeley, Leibniz, and essentially Ernst Mach was the guys, they were saying that this is impossible, that empty space could have such a tremendous potential, and they tried to attribute this centrifugal force to the existence of all objects surrounding, you know, this kind of this holistic view, right? That this force is due to the presence of all objects around me, right? When the moment that I'm rotating. So, and that's known as the Mach principle. And then Einstein was actually very familiar with this Mach principle, and he wanted to implement this principle into his general theory of relativity, but he failed. So, in a sense, he adopted the notion of absolute space and time as well. And also, his theory is called theory of relativity, but it's still based on the assumption of absolute space time. There are other interesting observations. This electrostatic and electromagnetic forces have the same form, actually, as the gravitational law. And this outgoing, please allow me to show only this, that there was a friend, and he was a contemporary of Einstein, that he developed the dynamic force, which has the same shape as to the law which describes all the electromagnetic phenomena we know nowadays. We are speaking about Maxwell equations, but Weber has an alternative description which is not known today, but it was this equation was capable to describe all electromagnetic phenomena. And because of the similarity, we also use this form to describe also the gravitational phenomena. And what is interesting here only that in a sense, is the extension of Maxwell's law, plus there are some extra terms which are dependent on the velocity and acceleration, but not anymore depending exactly as one or R squared. And this little modification, you know, has a tremendous effect on the whole physics, because, you know, let me just, you know the story, if you say, if I look at night on the sky, then it is, because I see stars, it's proof that the universe is not infinite. You know this argumentation? It comes from the fact that the stars, the light intensity coming from the stars to your eyes is, you know, falling as a function of R squared. So, you know, the farther the stars are, the intensity goes down. But the number of stars in the solid angle, I looking at the star, grows up also in the R squared. So these two cancel each other. So if the universe would be infinite, then you will see infinite number of stars from the night sky, right? And it's not the case, so that the people argue that just that you see the stars means that the universe cannot be infinite, right? That's kind of the historical. In the same way, you can also argue that any gravitational force from the distant star, if I assume they form kind of the symmetric shells around us, then any kind of gravitational force also cancels each other. And that was the argument why Newton assumed that the universe itself doesn't have any kinematical impact on the motions at the surface of the Earth, right? But if I now go to this Weber formulation, this little manipulation that I kind of give up the notion of the absolute space and time, he found that the force exerted by, you know, the spherical shell to some massive object inside the shell is actually proportional to the acceleration. So it gives rise to the second Newton law just from the fact that I give up the notation of the absolute space and time and just use this formula motivated from electrodynamics. So that's all for the, sorry for these technicalities, but this little change of viewing, you know, what's the space and what's the time and how it impacts, you know, the terrestrial kinematics, it has this little change has a tremendous consequences. For example, actually brings back the notion of ether, right, which was rejected by, you know, Einstein's law, because this gravitational field generated by our galaxy is this reference frame which is responsible for this accelerations and so on. It connects electromagnetism with gravity, which gives access to anti gravity, and I can show you the experiments which proves, you know, that this is not a speculation. If we had that, right, then it opens now to the new source of energy, called fusion. You know, experiment done, these are experiments in fact ignored by mainstream obviously. But if we go now to present to some, you know, mainstream conference, I'm afraid that we have to take into account the fate of Nikola Tesla, so that's why we have to carefully think what to do, right? Brings me now, you know, beyond the physics, and I will present a little bit what do we think and, you know, our research in terms of the consciousness, but very briefly, you know. So I think the big question, what is the objective reality, what is the origin, you know, where is all this reality we perceive, where is this coming from? So there are indications, and I think these are the kind of the main indications which I like also to think about. That's the ancient knowledge, you know, we have debated here a lot of, you know, Buddhism and so on. Then there is a modern science, namely the quantum physics. You know, quantum physics changed our kind of view on how the reality actually works. It's, you know, it was very big impact, right? And then there are mystical meditation or, you know, ayahuasca or things like that. And here the experience is also heavily discussed here. And everything kind of speaks into the direction that the reality is actually this, right? Thank you. And this life keeps me incredible. So it has many names, like void, nirvana, emptiness, heaven, you know, or I like to call it here and now. Right? Void, what is here and now, is not nothing, right? This life is not nothing, right? This life is actually everything potentially, right? Yeah. So this void, this state of, you know, which is kind of originally the state of this mystical experience or whatever, is the world of infinite potential. So everything is possible. Consciousness collapses the potential, so it means that into a reality, it means it's the same as a quantum wave function collapse. So that's exactly the problem of quantum measurement, right? We have the quantum wave functions, and the consciousness via the measurement makes the information from the wave functions. So reality is nothing but information, and I think there is a mistake by the world society, because the information should be called information, right? Because it exactly describes what it is. In that infinite potential, it makes the forms, it forms the reality, and it forms also the actions, right? So the reality, what we see, is called, comprises from forms and the interaction actions, right? So that's why it should be informed action, you know, each other, it makes sense. Right? Then brain, body, and I think the source of consciousness is kind of, or the consciousness related part of, it's not certainly only brain, it's the whole body, is a potential to information converter. Right? Understanding of how this conversion works is actually what we are all kind of up to, science, spirituality, theory of surreality, which was developed by my colleagues, you know, Robert here, and that's kind of the main research topic of our Prague institution, which is called Science 21. Right, so a little cartoon here, what I mean with that, so we have the classical view, right? So we have an observer represented here by this brain cross-section and the objective reality. And in the classical mechanistic view, this kind of related view of concurrent science, we say that there is a reality which exists independently of observer, and observer just observes some, you know, random events and so on. Then there is a quantum physics view, which is telling us that just the observation alters the reality. It means that whenever you observe something, you know, then you pick up from this infinite potential something, you pick up, you know, the bend, and the reality happens, the, you know, the quantum measurement, which also tells that without the observation, there is no reality, right? So if you, that's what has been also discussed, you know, we believe that all the particles, you know, I asked my students also that said, you know, we are working, you know, years and years with particles here, particle cracks and so on. How do you know that the particle exists? They actually don't exist, right? What we see is only a computer animation, right? There was a little energy here, then there was a little energy there, then here, so, and somehow you can, your brain connect that into a crack, but actually nothing exists, you know, so particle in the state that you don't measure, it exists only in this kind of form of the wave function, which is something complex related to probability only, but it's not a real object, right? It doesn't exist. Only if you measure at the short time, you can collapse the wave function to get the information, right? In terms of energy, whatever, but the particle never became a real particle. Always, you know, it was a wave, it will be a wave forever, right? So it means that whenever you don't observe, there is nothing. Just this potential. And the theory, you cannot, unfortunately, you cannot see it here, but what we believe, or I believe, is that actually the superposition of the signals in the brain, especially in the reticular formation, or something, a group EA, which are, you cannot see it here, but these are the dots here in this plane, are the informations complex information which resides in your brain, in your in this reticular formation, and the information connections, you know, so whenever you observe something, so it's based on the connections between the information which already exists in your brain, in a way that the connections are forming the whole cycle from here and now into the past and into the future in the same way. And whenever this circle is connected, which you cannot see here, then we are happy because it makes sense. You know, I see the tree, I have all the information about the tree, and I know, so it kind of defined the past of the tree, but, you know, some probably 100 years ago the tree was not here, so it should be planted and so on. And also, I see the connection into the future. At some point, somebody will go and cut the tree. And so this is making, you know, this information, conversion of information into a reality is kind of, like I can describe it mathematically, is given by the connection between the complex information residing in this, you know, in this system. And so, what I say is the, you know, that's, so in a sense, it's only the complete information. I am always giving the example, which is motivated by this generalized quantum mechanics, that we believe that this wave function and so on, this approach is very important for microscopic objects, but whatever you see here is the quantum physics also. Without quantum physics, you will not see anything, right? That's the light is quantum mechanical thing. And, you know, I give also this example. People believe, for example, I will get a letter from the taxation office, right, that I can find that I have to pay a lot of money back, or they will pay me money, right? In the moment that the letter is not open, we believe that the numbers are already given in that letter. But according to this quantum mechanical view, nothing exists until you observe. So in the moment you observe, you open the letter, only in that moment the number appears. And so whatever is not observed doesn't exist. And this is very possible for microscopic world, right? And then exactly what's happening is that you find that the value is that you get a lot of money, right? And this means that in that moment, this reticular information is making a new synopsis, new connection between the information into the past. Because I got the money, because I got a company, I work, I study, but also it makes all the kind of brain makes the connection to the past and also the future. But I will do this this month. Holidays and so on. So that's exactly how it works. And that also means that whenever this connection, the connection between this information is disconnected, right, then we call it miracle. Right? There is some doesn't go together, right? And or synchronicity, right? So this is a consequence of, you know, incomplete connection between the information into the brain. And if there is no information, there is no observation, if there is something for my brain that doesn't have any information, I just cannot perceive, I cannot see it. That's the case of this Coulomb ship, you know, this Coulomb ship, and Coulomb arrived to the US, and there is this famous story that the Indian didn't see the ships because they didn't have the information, they see only the waves on the water. And also this complex information analysis, kind of, that's what I said, forms the past and future, so that's the illusionary kind of, I mean, the space and time comes, past and future comes from just from the information. If we can have somebody who will be isolated from our complex information and we can construct his information in a different way, he will see totally different reality. Right? Very good. So I just mentioned that we have given the mathematical description of this procedure working with tensors and of vectors in the Hilbert space. I don't want to speak about that. But the main kind of, in conclusion, I would recall the Rupert Sheldrake kind of 10 scientific dogmas that should be questioned. And dogma number 3, that the laws of nature are fixed as the dogma, right? This is the idea that the nature laws were fixed at the moment of the Big Bang and will continue to be constant until the end of time. The habits of nature do not evolve. So I think nothing is fixed, and how it evolves depends on us. Thank you.
Thank you.